respected principal of this college, Padma Vibhushan, vice principal, Dr. Rose, known father Dr. Rose, Dr. C.P. Manchu, respected founders present, respected sisters present, esteemed invitees, and dear children. I consider it as a great privilege and an honor to be invited to deliver the third Chavara series of lectures on excellence in social transformation. How Sage Chavara has brought about tremendous social transformation through his sincere hard work, his spiritual approach to problems. This has been already explained to you by other Kuriakose. I will not be going into the three at this stage, but I want to speak to you how social transformation can be brought about by excellence in other areas as well. What is excellence? Excellence means excellent in everything, I would say. And what is excellent means what? It means surpassed in accomplishment. That is the meaning of excellent and excellence. I will place it for you three examples where I had the opportunity to be associated with, which through pure excellence in application, it has been possible to accomplish three important infra projects of this country. This has been already mentioned by Father Vishal. But I would like to place it for you how we accomplish it and what qualities were needed to accomplish these three projects. Out of these three projects, one is only actually a repair or restoration of a bridge or farming bridge. The other two are the Konkan Railway and the Delhi Metro. I would like to place before relating on details of these projects and what qualities and applications were needed to accomplish them. The Palmen Bridge is a railway bridge nearly 2 kilometers in length across the Palmen Strait, is called a portion of the Sea of Bengal, connecting the mainland of India and the Rameshwaram Island. This bridge was built in 1890 or so. A very marvelous bridge in the sense it allows trade to go from the mainland to Rameshwaram Island. At the same time, there is one particular span called Shelsa span, which is about 300 meters in length, which can open and allow ships to pass through. In those days, there were regular shipping service between India and Sri Lanka. And the ships were harbored at Mandapa, that is the base for the ships. And the services were from Dhanushkodi in Sri Lanka. Unfortunately, on the 23rd December 1963, the seedings of tidal waves raised as high as 15 to 20 meter high it appears. Today they call it tsunami. In those days it was called tidal wave. And the seedings of tidal waves came and washed up this bridge. The bridge consists of 146 spans of 48 girders and the 300 meter span trestle bridge. Of the 146 spans, 126 spans were washed up completely. In the process, two piers were also knocked off. And about the remaining 20 spans, which were with concrete girders, they got two of them got displaced. The worst tragedy in this equipment storm was a train, mostly carrying railway persons, going from Mandapam to Dhanushkodi. That whole train, which was carrying about 250 passengers, got completely washed. There was no trace of this train except the capsized steam engine lying by the side, and it had about six coaches. There was not even a sign of the coaches. They were all washed up along with the passengers. Only after about 3 or 4 days, the top of one of the coaches again came back to the seashore. That's all we know about the particular train and the passengers. See this huge tragedy and the possibility of this getting repeated again and again. The railways took the harsh decision not to restore the train services to Ramesh Shop anymore. They took that decision. But in Parliament, particularly members of Parliament from the North, who come and visit Ramesh Shop very frequently, they insisted that this bridge should be restored. And more fortunately, at that time, the general manager of Southern Railway was Mr. B.C. Ganguly, a person, a very known engineer from West Bengal. And he was a great devotee of Rameshwar. So he said the bridge should be restored. So ultimately, the railway board for the railway ministry relented and decided to restore the bridge. They got an estimate sanctioned by Southern Railway quickly and wanted to post an engineer to the site. I would say today, the good fortune to be selected for restoring this farmland bridge. I was at that time executive engineer at Bangalore. I was summoned from there and not rushed to the site for restoring the bridge. The railway board gave a target of 6 months for restoring the bridge. But on my way to Rameshwaram, the chief engineer called me and said, I must first come to Madras take instructions before proceeding to the site. And when I went to Madras, the chief engineer took me to the general manager. And the first instruction given to me was, we cannot wait for 6 months for the trains to be taken to Rameshwaram. We should get it done in 3 months after the most. Ladies and gentlemen, I would say divine grace. It was was possible for me to celebrate in exactly 46 days. As you now know, in the engineering details, how I was able to first celebrate. But the main reason was the main factors which has been accomplished is almost impossible task was in the engineering, in the engineering language, we can call it innovation. And then bringing in technology, latest technology possible. And during these 46 days, the two concrete girders which were dislocated had to be pulled down. The two piers which got locked had to be replaced. And 128 spans had to be restored back on the bridge. Now looking back, at that time when I inaugurated, I never thought it was a great task. Today, being a little more mature engineer, I feel it was a tremendous part that was accomplished and that in such a short time. And what benefit it has come with large number of pilgrims visiting Rameshwaram Island. That is, this is how excellence has been transformed, a complete change in the social setup, the way the pilgrims travel. This is a typical example of excellence playing a great part in achieving transformation. The other two examples are new assets created. One is the Konkan Railway. Konkan Railway now is very familiar to everyone. It's a 760 kilometer long railway line between Bombay and Mangalore. It passes through one of the most difficult terrains ever encountered in this year of railway history in our country. For that reason, although railway lines came from south of the Mangalore and from Bombay, another 40 kilometers, they never thought of building this section because of the difficult nature of the terrain. And this is the evidence when I mentioned what consisted of Konkan Railway. As many as 93 tunnels for a total length of 83.5 kilometers had to be bored through some of the most treacherous soils of Western Ghats. The longest tunnel on this line is 6.5 kilometers. And there are 9 tunnels which are more than 3 kilometers in length. And there are 159 major bridges across this, on this 160 kilometer route. The longest bridge is more than 2 kilometers in length across Sharavadi near Kawa. Because of the very elevating type of the terrain, the viaduct from one street to the other, the highest viaduct on this line is near Rathnagiri. The piers of this viaduct is as tall as Qutub Minar, which is about 70 meters in height. Despite of all these challenges involved in constructing this bridge, in fact the main challenge was not the technical challenges, but raising the money for finding money for such a challenging type of railway line. In those days, or even today, all new railway lines are constructed with government funds made available to to radio board or radio ministry to successful radio budgets. If that budget was wrong, this company would have taken, according to their money available in those days, would have taken 25 to 30 years for completion. So very innovative approach has been found out.
That decision goes to Calcutta.
where a metro was started in the early 70s. A 90-kilometer long metro was started in the early 70s and finally completed in 1986. I was fortunate to be associated with the Kolkata Metro as well as a young deputy chief engineer of planning and designs. But Kolkata Metro, though it's only 90 kilometers long, mostly I don't know about it, but it was not at all a very pleasant experience, either for Kolkata city as such or for the country as a whole. Because at that time, government people set up four metropolitan transport authorities, metropolitan transport project organizations, Kolkata, Delhi, Bombay, and Chennai, all with the intention of starting metros. But since the experience of Kolkata Metro, all attempts to have metros in the country came to a complete standstill because the 19-kilometer of Kolkata Metro took 22 years for completion and the cost went up by 15 times. This was a very miserable experience for the whole country. Therefore, the metro for Delhi was put on the shelf for a long time. Ultimately, it became impossible to carry the traffic in Delhi and the government in Delhi decided to start the Delhi metro. When Delhi metro was sanctioned in 1995, but they could not find a person to execute the project. At that time, it was in formal railway. The Delhi government decided that I should take over the Delhi metro. And for some time, I was looking after Delhi metro as well as formal railway. Till the last day, on formal railway was laid and completed, I was remaining in Bombay, then moved up to the Delhi metro. Today, Delhi can boast of having a modern world-class metro. To start with, only the first phase one of Delhi metro was sanctioned. That was, as I told you, in 1996 it was sanctioned. But the actual work on the metro started only on 1st October 1998. When the phase one of the metro was handed over to Delhi Metro Rail Corporation, Delhi Metro Rail Corporation is again a government company owned 50% by Government of India and 50% by Government of Delhi. It's a government company. It's just the way Government Rail Corporation also is a fully owned government company. When this model was handed over to DMRC or Delhi Metro Rail Corporation, the mandate from the government was to complete the phase one in 10 years' time, which was specified in the detailed project report for the phase one. So when I took over the project, I helped the city of Delhi, which is the capital of the country, cannot wait for 10 years for getting a metro. So on our own, we decided that we would complete Delhi metro in 7 years' time. And not wait for 10 years. Fortunately, fund was not a problem. Unlike the common gradient fund was a real game problem. We were not able to raise money from the market. And there were days when we could not pay the contractors in time, but of course we were able to pay the staff and officers. Then we went to fund was not a problem. But the difficulty in executing a project of that type in the capital city of Delhi. From the experience of Kolkata Metro, we realized that this cannot be completed like Delhi Kolkata Metro. It has to be done in a new fashion, a new way. And that is how DMRC was formed. And the first phase of Delhi Metro, we were able to complete. Though we took a target of 7 years, it took so many years, 3 months for the first stage to be done. Even so, it is 2 years and 9 months ahead of schedule that the government sets. And most important, the first phase of Delhi Metro was done exactly within the sanction cost of 10,400 crores. This gave engagement to the government to start the ratio of Delhi Metro straight away. And the sanction phase to Delhi Metro, covering 124 kilometers. The first phase was only 64 kilometers, second phase was 124 kilometers. At a cost of 24,000 crores. And the target given to us was to finish the second phase in 6 years. The government also got the credit that it could be done quickly. But then, at that time, the country got the chance to hold the Commonwealth Games in Delhi. And the Commonwealth Games in the date fixed for the Commonwealth Games meant that the second phase of Delhi Metro should be completed in 4.5 years' time. So we were called to do that the second phase should be completed in exactly 4.5 years' time. And dear children, I'm very happy to inform you that the last line of Delhi Metro phase 2 was commissioned on the very morning on which the Commonwealth Games were inaugurated. If Delhi Metro Phase 2 was not completed, you would imagine how about 75,000 people assembled in Jawaharlal Nehru Stadium to be registered on the function. It was just not possible. We were able to evacuate all the people after the function. Then exactly 1.5 hours time, running trains every 90 seconds from that station, it was possible. That was the advantage of the Delhi Metro. The condition of the phase two is going on, which again covers the 145 kilometers, and the work is going on, gradually they are opening section by section. And the fourth phase has also been sanctioned. When the four phases of Delhi Metro are completed, Delhi can boast of a metro network covering 450 kilometers. By that time, Delhi will be the fourth biggest metro in the world. That time. Now, how these transformations could be brought in? What are the excellence behind these big projects that I mentioned to you, which enabled us to come to peace? Ladies and gentlemen, these are only, all these are government bodies, government departments, government companies. And naturally, they will follow the government rules, government procedure, and governmental policies in implementing all these treaties. The common bridge was clearly a department of Indian Railways. The other countries had companies who were involved for autonomy. These were able to accomplish this is only because excellence in project execution. I would say. And what is this excellent? What social transformation it has brought in that will explain a little more. But what is this excellence that came up in the execution of these big projects? This can be summarized broadly in four categories. One is, I am only giving the important pillars of the work culture of these three organizations. First and foremost is integrity. Second is punctuality. Third is professional competence and fourth, social commitment. These things I want to explain to you a little more because they are very important to the aspiring young citizens of this students of this college. What are we standing for? First, integrity. When I mention integrity, it is just not honesty alone or absence of corruption. It is something much more than that. If you take the Oxford Dictionary and see the meaning of integrity, it means having good moral values. I think these are not a great relevance to the students assembled here. Having good moral values. Father Joseph Kuriakose in his address mentioned about all the values in our nation are declined by and most of the social problems we find today is only because of this decline of these moral values. So the importance of these moral values you can really understand. And more than that, I can tell you that in life, if you want ultimately to achieve anything, you must have high integrity. Professor Thomas mentioned saying that he has brought me here specifically to give you some sort of a motivation on inspiration. I want to tell you that my main strength is this integrity. What should otherwise the government, after my retirement, I retired from the Indian Railways before I took up these projects, huge projects involving thousands and thousands of crores. As a retirement, the government has no hold on me at all. How did the government decide to entrust me in these projects involving huge crores of rupees? It's only because of the integrity. Integrity is a trait one should practice right from the early days. As you grow, your reputation for integrity should spread out. I would even go to the extent of saying that integrity should be a passport in your pocket all the time. Wherever you go, the world should know that, yes, here is a person who is really honest and who can be trusted upon. This is very important. For example, if you take the Commonwealth Games, you know how the Commonwealth Games are over? Almost everybody involved in the Commonwealth Games, there were allegations against them. This appropriation of funds, manipulation of accounts, things like that. The biggest player in the Commonwealth Games was Delhi Metro. There was not even a single allegation against Delhi Metro that there was something had gone wrong. That shows if you have people with integrity, the organization gets a reputation for integrity, and we are even fix that reputation for integrity. Even if you make a mistake, nobody will attribute it to anything wrong. They will not give you the wrong motive for that mistake. They will only say, yes, it's a mistake, it should be corrected immediately, that's all. So integrity is very important. I will come to this little later also when I speak to you about the character that is required. The next is punctuality. I am very happy to see today's punctuality. I'm exactly punctual. What is my punctuality? Punctuality is nothing but a courtesy you show to the time of others. the respect you show to the client of the other person. That is punctuality. I learned my sense of punctuality from my engineering college. We had a professor, Professor Sitali, who was so punctual, meticulous in punctual. And wanted every student to be so punctual. He used to come to classes, wait outside the room, and the classes are done at 30, you'll enter exactly at 11:30. And the class is over at 12:15, you will be punctual at 12:15. And all the time, you should keep your watch, people are punctual or not. This punctuality you should learn from a college of this time. A college has got reputation for discipline. Punctuality is so important in all your life. And in your career, later on in life as well. Just imagine the emphasis on punctuality, how it has affected pomegranate and the green control. We want to complete pomegranate in 7 years' time. And when we exactly in 7 years' time, we were able to complete pomegranate. A sense of punctuality. Observed by everyone involved in the project. And these two projects are meant for running trains. Please understand that you can't expect your trains to be punctual. Unless all the employees are also punctual as well. That is most important. And see the follow of this philosophy in Delhi Metro. Where when I stepped down to Delhi Metro in December 2011, at that time, the punctuality of Delhi Metro, I want to explain to you the importance of punctuality of an organization. And an organization consists of individuals, so everyone has to practice this punctuality. World over, the punctuality of metro trains is reckoned in 3 minutes. If a train is within 3 minutes of destination, it is due to punctuality. If it is later by 3 minutes, then it loses the punctuality. Only thing that is 10 minutes. Metro is 3 minutes. But we decided to accommodate that we will tighten our belts and we will have 60 seconds as the for punctuality, for reckoning punctuality. The least count should be 60 seconds. That means if a train is late by more than 60 seconds, it loses punctuality. And then in metro, all the trains are on completely on computers, everything is monitored on computers, so nobody can fudge the figures. In December 2011, the punctuality of metro trains was 99.97%. More than that, I consider the sense of punctuality is what enables us to complete these big projects I mentioned to you on time. We should keep the reverse clock at all the work sites and all offices, which will keep the number of days left for completing a project. Even today, from Delhi Metro, if you come to my office, you will find the reverse clock, which will show how many days are still left for completion in the first section. Each day, the government will reduce by one day, and this becomes a constant reminder for everyone that only so many days are left for completing this project. All these goals offer a sense of maturity. The third I mentioned to you was professional competence. Of course, these three projects I mentioned to you are highly technical. Many of the areas of technology was not available in the country. For example, for a modern world-class metro, the technology was just not available in the country. We have to bring in the technology and grow the technology within the country itself. This is possible only if you know your subject well. Dear children, knowledge is very supreme. I would say knowledge is strength. Jnana Naiva Jnana. Magsaysay Award for the Knowledge is real strength. Our structural or spiritual exchange, Nyanami is a person, or we can even have it here. This is last week, I'll translate it over. Indeed, there is nothing more sacred than knowledge. All of you persons here are very, very lucky, I should say, to have the opportunity to enter a world of this, like such reputation, get education from very learned and devoted lecturers and teachers, a college which is in their guest as the best in Kerala today. You are very, very lucky. Please see that. You may be sure you are finding this college very, very fruitful. Of course, this college will give you only the basic things for your knowledge. But most importantly is learn good habits, good character, good conduct in this college. That is more important. I will say that that is also part of the knowledge. The fourth thing I mentioned was social responsibility. All of us are individuals, but we are part of the society. The society is a part of the nation. If this society has to be transformed, if the nation has to be transformed, every one of us has to contribute to it. That is where excellence is called. In all this project which I mentioned, I thought the first social responsibility was completing the projects on time or before time, completing them within the estimated cost. That is the first social responsibility, which I think is very, very sacrosanct, very important. I remember the day when Dr. Thomas called me from Delhi one day and told me that there is a big problem at Pachala. Level crossing is there. Can you find that level crossing has been going on for the last 10 or 30 years? Can you find a solution by it? And all of which can be considered the past. I did not know at all what Pachala was at that time. I went and studied that. And came up with a solution by which we would consult it very quickly and at very reduced cost. The project was explained to him. He really agreed to it and wants to take how much willingness immediately to take it up as a preparatory work for the achievement. Because Delhi Metro could not take up what's outside, yet it was made part of the Kochi Metro. And you can see what Sreedharan is doing today to public there. But one thing I want to mention here is the way that project was conceived, the way the project was executed, and in the process, how much money is saved on that particular project. If I remember correct, we have saved something like 20 crores, I think, to the state government by completing it on time. Similarly, all the projects that we completed, DMRC is taken up in Kerala, that is Kochi Metro. Kochi Metro today, there is a saving of 100 crores. In Chavara, at the Kathale, there is a saving of almost 19 crores. We did a flyover, a road of which, at Pandigana, at Bodhipur, recently, 2 months back when it was open, the saving was 19 crores a year. All done in time and at the same time saving in the days. This is what I call social responsibility. Whatever we do, one will do it perfectly well. Excellence, this is what excellence is called. And I mentioned to you what excellence means. Excellence means excellent in everything. And excellent means surpass the accommodation. Whatever is possible to be accommodation, you surpass it. Do it much of it. This is excellence. So governments of excellence in any social transformation, governments of excellence in any national transformation is so important. I don't know the details, technical details of these projects I mentioned to you, but I only wanted to convey this before you. What qualities are required to accommodate qualities of this type? Apart from the four qualities I mentioned to you, there are some more things I want to place before you. One is the need for good health. If you want to accomplish anything, you must be very healthy. You can't always go to your hospital and depend on the hospital to do your work. If you want to really promote your work, and if you don't want to be a source of worry to your parents or spouses, you have to be very healthy. This is one thing I want to convey to students persons here. It applies equally well to boys as well as girls. Most of the girls, I would say. If you are really healthy, now there is a self-assurance in whatever you do. You are confident of doing things the way you want. You don't depend upon somebody else. And you don't become a source of worry to anyone, your parents. And to be healthy is so easy. It's nothing. It's only a few things that you have to be very careful. Basically, I would say, proper food, nourishing, balanced diet, which we are all educated people, you know what's a balanced diet, I don't have to worry about the details. Adequate sleep is very important. Today, the TV and the cell phone, and the messages that we get on the cell phone, people spend all the time on the cell phone and the TV in front of the TV and computer. And this affects their sleep. The sleep varies from individual to individual. Some people need 8 hours sleep. Some people need only 6 hours sleep. But adequate sleep is very important. If you want to keep your memory very fresh, if you want to remember things, and you want to be agile and energetic, it is important. Adequate sleep. Don't, I would say, burn midnight oil. Early to bed, early to get up is a good, even today, is so relevant, so important for this process. This is not very difficult. You have plenty of time to do that. Even at this age, I am now nearly 85. I can wait for a while, but I go to bed at 9:30. And because I'm able to get up early, you have plenty of time to do many things. For example, today, Martin will first check on my duty. I get up before I leave for nanny at 5 o'clock. Usually my duty. Come to Kochi by about 7 o'clock, have my breakfast. And I'm in the office by 8:15. So much time is available to me. This practice is a must cultivate. I know many of you will be very conscious, very unwilling to it, but it is so important. If you want to have an ample time for doing your work. Then the third thing is, you must have proper exercise. Good exercise. Merely walking to college, or walking inside the college, or doing work at home is not exercise. You must have exercise in a relaxed, relaxation pain. It must give you new energy. It must give you stamina. That means exercise is required. Either brisk walking or jogging or skipping, anything that is alright. So important. And the fourth component of good health is a pure mind. Purity of the mind is very important for good health. If you harbor all these negative thoughts, hatred towards somebody, anger against somebody else, cursing the world, cursing the classes, you say you cannot work in the world. What is known as Manatasara, or Bhava Sanchiti, this is all purity of thought, purity in mind. I have seen this very, very useful in my life. If you have and literally in a college, you are always teaching people who are doing good service, social service, all the time. No, learn from them. What is motivating them to do this sort of thing? I think this is very important. Only last week, I was giving a lecture in Kottayam, I was ultimately a set of a foundation day. When I mentioned this aspect of good health, all the doctors wasn't really surprised. How a mind can cure diseases? How mind can prevent diseases from you? This is nothing but purity of mind. Lastly, I come to a very important topic, character. This is it. Which many of us hear my very, very closely brought out in his speech the importance of this habit. Dear children, the crown and glory of life is character. I'm repeating it, the crown and glory of life is character, good conduct. This good character is partially inherited, not cultivated. You inherit it from your parents, from your family, but you cultivate it in a knowledge at least, in the society, in the marketplace. Anyone, you cultivate a good character. What is wrong in having a good character? Today, what is happening with some of the incident that is happening is worrying people like me very much. How students can think of learning a chair out of a system? That too a very good system. Having come to that sort of culture in this country, a country that boasts of centuries of good culture. How in a college students can learn the efficacy of a principle which happened in Kuriakose College? This is all because of the decline in good character. Parents also have to take equal care to see that students are well grown properly, the children are well grown, put in the right way. This is very, very important. Good character and good conduct. You will become an exceptional person anywhere with a good character. Anywhere you go. Dear children, it is not what position you occupy that is important. It is not what salary that you draw that is important. It is not the bank account that you have that is important. What is important is what is that you pay back to the society. How much you pay back from what you have received from the society. You are all studying in this college. You can pay back to society the way when you work and you are in good position. Come and help this institution. Whatever if you are able to do to good for this, to this institution, do it. Don't forget this institution because it put you in this pedestal. Behavior of majesty. On the point, behavior of majesty is very important. So, sort of character of excellence and intellectual elegance. These three things is always keep in your mind if you want to be a good citizen of this society. I'm very happy. I did not come with a prepared written lecture, which is normally the case. When a where commemoration thing is given. I thought I was speaking from my own heart. Can you see that someone wants to say very important to take back home? Think about it. And if what Professor Thomas has done, maybe if you have to before you, if at least some of the things which I have told you are able to invite, I have thought, I hope that as a very satisfactory.